It's a great pleasure to be here today. You know, some of my oldest and best friends are here, and I think you can say the same thing, Rosita.
Yes.
What we'd like to do today, first of all, welcome, this is a real privilege for us. It's sort of a milestone in our collaboration where Rosita and I started, we'll tell you in a few minutes, back in 1986, and we've been chugging along ever since. We're going to just sort of reminisce through a bunch of slides, talk about a project that we did and how it started really small and started growing and growing and growing and growing and took over our lives completely for 3 decades so far. And the garden has many, many, many projects. You know, we work in some of the most remote parts of the world and also at the molecular level doing genomics and DNA work. And, this is a project about phytochemistry and looking for new medicines, part of it, and preserving ancient cultures, what's called biocultural diversity. So bear with us. We're just going to reminisce a little bit, talk about slides. We'll talk about plants. Most importantly, we'll talk about those elders that were so generous to us over all these years and whose knowledge is documented in this book. And it was the knowledge that they wanted documented so that future generations could benefit from it. So
you remember Don Alicio's statement when I asked him if he would collaborate with you and the New York Botanical Garden, and I explained that Michael was a scientist and that we would be collecting plants for cancer and AIDS research, and Don Alicio said, I guess those scientists aren't so dumb after all.
So, as an introduction, ethnobotany is the study of the relationship between plants, people, and culture. And that's my specialty, and that's what Rosita and Greg Shropshire worked on for 3 decades with us. But I always give credit to my professor, as we always credit our elders. This is Richard Evan Schultes on the left, with the Yukuna and Tony Muka dancers in the northwest Amazon Valley of Colombia in 1952. Professor Schultes, who was a Harvard professor, got a 1-year leave of absence to go to the Amazon around this time. And what I love about back then is that the piece of paper sat in his personnel file for 14 years until a Harvard bureaucrat found it and told him he had to come home. And so he was there 14 years straight living in the Amazon, and he was the one that really imbued in his students the love of indigenous people and their wisdom and the fact that they were our teachers. We weren't there except to learn at their feet, and that was the spirit of this project, I would say.
I would say so too, exactly.
So the gentleman on the left has a bachelor's, master's, and PhD from Harvard University. They've been dancing for 2 days straight with a celebration of the harvest of the peach palm. A wonderful man. Ethnomedicine is the study of the relationship between people, their environment, culture, and healing practices. So that's a branch of ethnobotany. And that's really what Rose, Greg, and I specialize in. Traditional medical knowledge, why is it threatened? Well, here's a couple of reasons. One is habitats are being destroyed. So this is a picture of the Atlantic coastal forest of Brazil in the state of Bahia. 1945, this is Bahia, the area. Look at all the forest that was there. 1990, only 1% left. And we see that all over the world. The garden's work is extremely important in combating this. We have boots on the ground in, I think, 30 countries right now of people working with local communities to conserve habitat. That's one reason. The next reason is that languages and cultures are going extinct. Of the 6,800 languages on Earth today, it's predicted that only 600 will survive. And in fact, what's really cool is that New York City has speakers of 800 different languages within the 5 boroughs, including some endangered languages that are only spoken by a few hundred people. So as language disappears, people don't know their cultural stories. And when they don't know their cultural stories, they don't understand the plants and animals and oceans and their environment and the way of traditionally managing them. And when you don't have respect for that, you can't conserve it. So culture becomes very important, hence the term biocultural conservation. So the story really begins when we got a collection project from the National Cancer Institute to be the organization that would collect in the neotropics, Central and South America and the Caribbean, providing about 1,200 specimens a year for evaluation against 40 forms of human tumor systems and HIV/AIDS. And our focus, as I said, was the neotropics, Central and South America and the Caribbean. And these are the countries that our staff worked in. And I chose to, during that 10-year period, I chose to work in Belize because this lady wrote me a letter back in 1986. And I'll share a little piece of that letter, but this is Rosita in those early...
1984 with Don Alicio. And I had just, that was my first year of a 13-year apprenticeship with this old Maya bush doctor who was really the Maya shaman of Central America. We're just coming home from a collecting trip.
And this was the piece of the letter.
I have been working very closely this past year and a half with an old Mayan bush doctor. We have taken on the project of recording and chronicling Don Eligio's medicinal plants and healing system. My husband and I could clearly see what was about to be lost to the world because no one else seems to care about it anywhere. We do.
So I had written in, I think, the introduction to Sassoon, Rosita's memoir of the time with Don Eligio, that I've got a lot of letters at that point. And this one sort of rose to the top. It had some magic to it. And
also, I sent about 50 letters to different scientists.
So the wonderful thing about the Botanical Garden, being a scientist here, you have a full-time commitment to research. So 2 weeks after getting that letter, first, maybe I never told you this, but I called our mutual friend Tim Plowman, the late Tim Plowman, and said, are these people crazy or are they okay? And he said, no, they're wonderful. I said, well, why aren't you going down there? He said, no, I've got other things. He was studying the coca leaf at the time, which consumed his life's work.
That was in Chicago at the Natural History Museum,
Field Museum.
The Field Museum. And Tim Plowman was kind enough to be the first person to give us a field press kit to press plants and also teach us how to press plants and how to take ethno-medical research documentation data. It was a fabulous boot up for our first beginning days in the project.
So this is the farm over here, right? This part. And so I flew down there, and you picked me up at the airport, and it was sort of very beautiful and very nice. And I remember there was no shower, there was a water tank, and you kind of opened the water tank and held on and not, you know, you weren't blown away by the pressure. And
there's no electricity.
Yeah.
It was an old wood stove. It was 30 acres of uncleared jungle in the Belizean rainforest that Greg and I had only since 1982. So it was only the second year of our time in this uncleared piece of jungle.
That's the laundromat.
And at that time you could drink out of it.
At that time you could drink out of the river.
And go ahead.
So here I am on the Rainforest Medicine Trail. When I realized that we had not only 30 acres of uncleared rainforest, but dozens, perhaps 100 different types of useful and medicinal plants, I asked Don Eligio to come to our piece of farm and walk through this trail, was not a trail yet, walk through the jungle with me and point out the useful and medicinal plants. And it turns out that within a day or two, he had 50 plants designated, and we just tied little ribbons around them. And then my son spent the time painting up every one of those little signs. This is a vine that grows in the forest, and you can see how thick it is. It's called bull hoof. There's one of the leaves that looks just like the imprint of a bull in the mud, and its Mayan name is Kibish, and it's Bauhinia divaricata. So for a period of about 25 years, we conducted trail walks through the jungle on what was called the Rainforest Medicine Trail, and this lady right here was one of those guests years ago on the medicine trail. And Don Eligio Ponte, as you can see, the very, very noble Maya profile, looks like he could have posed for one of those stelae on the Maya stone pyramids. So at this time, Don Eligio was only about 92 years old, and he lived to be 103. And Michael took this picture on the first day in the forest, accompanied us to do our usual morning collection of the plants that he used in his healing clinic. Don Eligio could go through a few hundred pounds of medicine every week. So it was a daily job of bringing in vines, roots, barks, and leaves, and carrying everything on your back, because he said at 92, he lost patience with donkeys.
And of course, he was a great chaman or healer priest. This is one of the Diego Rivera murals from the Hospital de la Raza in Mexico City. This is called the Historia de la Medicina. And of course, he was married to Frida Kahlo, right? And we're featuring Frida until October 31st. And everyone must see that exhibit. But this is his mural that was dedicated to elders teaching younger people the art of healing. And in those days, there were schools of medicine. There were many, many, many books, textbooks, and there were formal teachings, and that all came to an end with the conquest. So the real problem with traditional knowledge, not only here, but around the world, is that it went, in this case, it went from a written tradition to an oral tradition to one that the chain was beginning to pull apart. And we didn't want that to happen. And we thought we should record that information and get people excited once again in traditional living as a way of empowering them in a world that was constantly changing, that would bring them improved medical care, resilience, improved nutrition. But we do see in our projects around the world that when something shifts to oral tradition, the younger people get seduced by Western society and all the accoutrements that it brings, and they begin to forget first their language, then their understanding of the environment, their names for plants, animals, sea creatures. And then, as I said in the beginning, once that happens, everything starts to come apart, and you can see the level of healthcare, for example, of a people begin to crash. Their diets begin to just get terrible. Their life expectancy goes from, in the Pacific, for example, where I'm working now, from 90s to about the 50s because of the diet changes and things like that. So
I'd just like to point out, if you don't mind, on that slide, that Diego Rivera took the time to copy many pages of the Bodianus manuscript. And that's what you have here, these different plant drawings, illustrations that were actually done by an Aztec healer in the 16th century. This is the first American herbal. There you see the aloe vera up there, and here you see the nopal, the opuntia species. So I thought it was fascinating the way the ancients did all of these little balls of roots, according to the color, told you their habitat.
So at the end of, I was there about a week, I guess, or maybe a little longer. And after we came back, you used to walk 7 miles, I think, from Don Eligio's village, crossing that river, which Greg called the laundromat, and then climbing up the hill back to the farm. And we sort of looked at each other one day and said, you know what, let's do a project that's going to change the course of history for these people in this one place. And let's catalog the information. Do you want to explain what Don Eligio said about working with us?
Don Alicio said that he felt that if he worked with us, that the knowledge that he had, which young people seem to no longer care about. He said, if I go to young people and tell them I want to show them the plants that I use to teach them so that the knowledge doesn't die, they laugh at me. And they say, we don't believe in that stuff any longer, old man, but you and this doctor are here to learn about it, and I feel that if I share what I have with you, I have given it to the world, and that it will be saved.
And what was so touching to me is he said, you know, people don't respect my culture and my civilization anymore. And what I think we can do with this, if I tell you the plants that I work with, I think we can build a bridge from your society to my ancient society. And when we've done that, I will feel free to rejoin my wife in heaven. And that's exactly what...
That was the concept he had in mind, was a bridge between his world and this world, and that he would be the person who laid down the bricks of the bridge.
So in a great sort of metaphorical way, Rosita and I stood on a unexcavated Maya ruin site and shook hands and said, we will do this. And it was unexcavated because our work was unexcavated at the time. And I'll be back in a few months or a month or whatever it was. And I started commuting. When I last checked, there were something like 54 stamps on my passport. Yeah.
And this is Zunantinich Maya Ruins, which is about 5 miles from where we live in Belize. It's our neighborhood Maya temple.
So getting up early in the morning, collecting plants with Don Eligio. Do you want to talk about his prayer?
Yes. Don Eligio said that every plant that is taken from the earth or from any plant part has to be collected with prayer and thanksgiving. And he always said, many people come here, they want to see what medicines I use, how I prepare them. They go home, they have the same plant, the same preparation, but no trabaja, it doesn't work. Why? Because they didn't say the prayer. And this is his prayer, in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Don Eligio was a Catholic Maya. I take the life of this plant and I give thanks to its spirit. I am Don Eligio, the one who walks in the mountains, collecting medicine to heal the ailments of the people. I have faith with all my heart that this plant will heal the sickness of the people. Of course, he said it in Spanish, in the nombre de Dios Padre, Dios Hijo y Dios Espíritu Santo. Yo tomo la vida de esta planta y le doy gracias a su espíritu. Yo soy Don Eligio, el que anda en el monte buscando la medicina para curar las enfermedades de la gente. Tengo la fe con todo mi corazón que esta planta va a curar las enfermedades de la gente. And every time every plant, vine, root, or bark came out of the forest, it came with that prayer. And then he said, the spirit of the plant follows you home to help with the healing, that there is more than the physical medicine. There's also the spiritual aspect of having given thanksgiving to the plant. Here, Don Eligio is chopping medicine. Our usual routine was to be up at dawn and then be in the forest by 6 o'clock, 6:30 in the morning, collect plants all morning, and then come home in the afternoon. There are the roots of the plant that Don Eligio collected the most of, skunk root, and then chop medicine for the rest of the morning, lay it out in the sun to dry, and then spend the afternoon treating upwards of 35 to 40 patients a day. And sometimes by the end of the day, all the medicine we collected in the morning was gone already. Here is Don Eligio's clinic, his consultation room, full of medicinal plants. And right there, you see the Mexican wild yam, the Dioscorea, called Belicensis, right? Dioscorea Belicensis, which was the plant that gave the molecule for the birth control pill and cortisone. Two of our most often used medications of modern world came from that humble little tuber. So Don Alicio always sat here, I sat there, and there he did his consultations on that little table.
And I sat with a pencil and paper and a camera standing at the doorway because it was a tiny place.
And one aspect of Don Alicio's work was Maya spiritual healing. If you ask Don Alicio what was his most powerful healing tool, he always had one word answer, prayer. Prayer. And here you see him reciting prayers for a baby who has a spiritual disease called pesar. Pesar in Spanish means heavy. It refers to grief. This little baby has grief because the mother is pregnant and had to take him off the breast. And he hasn't stopped crying for days.
And one of the modalities that he used was called pulse diagnosis. He would recognize around 30 different kinds of pulse, as physicians in this country hundreds of years ago used to do, that were reflective of everything from total health to impending death. Interestingly, when we published this paper, his system, we compared it to Chinese medicine, and we found about a 40%, 30 to 40% overlap in this recognition of the different pulse types that Chinese traditional practitioners recognize. And this man, who was the last practitioner knowledgeable of pulse diagnosis, he recognized. And then randomly, we would expect 10 or 20% overlap. So then you have to ask the question, why is there so much overlap? Well, how many of you read that book? Was it
1492?
Yeah, the year
1492.
The year China discovered America.
Mm-hmm.
And when the Chinese fleets had come and crashed, actually, one of them in Maya territory. And so is there Chinese blood in these people? Did they learn from Chinese physicians who were on board those ships?
Every one of those ships had thousands of people
on
it. So if one ship crashed somewhere along the Gulf Coast or somewhere along the Yucatan Peninsula, thousands of Chinese people scattered out throughout the lands, and they could not go back. So there they were, and there is some evidence that the Chinese physicians left some of their knowledge and wisdom of pulse diagnosis and treatment of ailments with the Maya people. So this is Don Alicio's sastun in his hand right there. It's a little crystal ball that is placed into a very small clay jar. That was what Don Alicio said just showed up on his doorstep. The word is teleported. Teleported from the Maya spirits. The sastun just came one day as a gift from the spirits. And then also the little clay jar, which looked like it was from very ancient days, showed up shortly after that. He would put that little crystal ball, the sastun. Sastun in Maya is a word. Sas means light or mirror. Tun is stone or age. Sastun is mirror of the ages or stone of light or crystal ball. And here you see the little black package there. That is a protección, a amulet. And he is enchanting the amulet for the benefit of the person who asks for it, for protection, for good luck, and sometimes just for protection against envy. So he's enchanting it with the sastun, and that was a good more than half of his daily work was in Maya spiritual healing.
And I remember you told me a sastun appeared outside your door one day, and that's when you knew that you had to take on his work.
That's right, and that's when he agreed then to teach me everything, when a sastun appeared.
What I didn't tell you is that one day one appeared outside my door, and I still have it. It's a little crystal ball, and I didn't want to take on the responsibility.
Chicken.
I wanted to come back to the Bronx, and so I have it at home. And whether the tooth fairy delivered it, or a very dear friend, or the Maya spirits, I'll never know. But I got one as well. So if we look at the patients that Don Alicio saw, we interviewed 361 patients during a 2-year period. Rose and sometimes me, we just sat there and we would take data. So this is sort of his patient profile. These are the ages. So he was a general practitioner, but he also specialized in pediatrics and treating elders. So a real full range. And what's amazing to me is that he had no apprentice until Rosita showed up. You know, and here's a guy, we estimated his patient load was about 3,500 people a year. Where did they come from? You'll see a lot of different countries there, from Honduras, from El Salvador, Guatemala, Mexico. So people would come from as far away as they could by boat, by canoe, by walking, by bus, by car.
Horse.
Forgot about the horse. And so about 15% of his patients came from so far away outside the country. And astonishing, he had no apprentice. What did they come for? Well, these were the patient complaints. Stomach ache, muscular, skeletal, we understand that. But also things like fright, crying hysteria, romantic enchantments, bad luck. These were the Western diagnosticians would call these psychiatric conditions. So not only was he his internal medicine specialist, but also a treater of the spirit and the mind.
That's what his designation in Maya, Hemen. It's the word for shaman. It simply means he or she who knows. If you refer to Don Eligio as a shaman, he would say, why are you calling me the Northern Star? Shaman means Northern Star. So the word is Hemen.
And so if you looked at the categories of illness as he explained them, 37% were non-physical or supernatural causes. So naturally, he had to treat them that way. Whoops. And close to three quarters of his treatments included prayer, incense, magic, amulet, sort of the equivalent perhaps of talk therapy that one might get from a psychiatrist. But prayer, we know prayer is a powerful healing modality.
Empathy. Lots of empathy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So here are some of the spiritual ailments.
Right. Susto. Many of you here who are of Hispanic descent know exactly what susto means. It's fright or post-traumatic stress disorder. A sudden shocking event in your life changes your heartbeat, changes the pulse rate, and affects every aspect of your physiological being. Pesar is grief from having lost something very dear to you or someone. It could be due to death, perhaps a fire in which you lost every precious belonging that you own, or maybe you were thrown out of school and you no longer have the career you were hoping for, you could no longer afford. That is grief. Tristeza is sadness. It's much more than depression. Over the years of being Don Eligio's apprentice, what I learned is that people with tristeza seem to have been unwanted children. And so they have an entire lifetime of feeling like they are a disappointment to someone. So that is my interpretation of tristeza. Envy, envidia is what you get when someone who is close to you daily looks upon your life, your belongings, your home, your career with envy and jealousy. Pretty soon it begins to make you sick. Mal ojo is simply the evil eye. I grew up in an Italian immigrant household and my grandmother always warned me about malocchio. Malocchio is the evil eye. So it's a type of envy, but it's when people stare at your beauty or stare at your new shoes or stare at your car, and that intensity of the gaze with jealous intents eventually makes you sick as well. Maldad is actual evil magic where people pay necromancers, if you will, to do harm to people that have angered them or who they have so much jealousy against, they have to begin to break down their lives to get satisfaction. Malvientos, probably the most difficult of all the spiritual diseases for us to understand. Mal vientos are spirits that move through the atmosphere. There is the most common one is the mal viento of women who sit on the doorstep at dusk brushing their hair. Because their hair is long and black and shiny, the Maya spirits that is a mal viento is very jealous of that long, shiny black hair. So he enters as an evil wind into the arm that's brushing the hair. And I can't tell you how common that physical, spiritual ailment was in Don Eligio's clinic, mal viento de los Mayas. So they are errant spirits that are in and of the wind.
And there's a framework for this in modern psychiatry. This is the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Medical Disorders, the DSM-4. There's now a DSM-5. But there's an entire appendix with the 25 best-studied culture-bound syndromes. These are called culture-bound syndromes that might be encountered in a clinical setting in New York, in North America. So if you're a physician in New York City in the emergency room, there is a good chance that someone will come in and present with susto or malojo. And how they define it is a recurrent locality-specific pattern of aberrant behavior and troubling experience. And there's seldom a one-to-one equivalence with any specific psychiatric diagnostic category. So it's sort of a mix of things.
What this means is people tell me, I feel it when I go to work. Somebody at work is jealous of their position or promotion. I feel bad, I feel sick to my stomach as soon as I put the key in the door to go home. Somebody in the house, usually an aunt or an in-law who just moved in, is feeling jealous of that person. So that's what locally specific means.
And one of the, for me, there was an interesting one in there where someone loses it and starts going ballistic and chopping people up and all of that. And it's an Indonesian culturally specific illness called amok. And it's come into our language of going amok. But that's from the Indonesian and it's from a specific illness, a cultural specific illness.
These are the categories of traditional healers that Michael and I discovered, studied while we were in Belize. The doctor priest or priestess is the Jimen. That was Don Eligio. And one other woman down south amongst the Garifuna population, Miss Sarah, who has also recently passed away. The village healer is the person who works directly under the doctor priest, and that is the granny or grandfather, grandmother, who has so much experience treating. In this environment and culture, people have as many as 80 or 90 grandchildren. It's not unusual at all. So after you've taken care of 15 of your own children, all of your grandchildren, you have so much experience, you become the village healer, the person that most people refer to if there is no Jimen. And then the granny healer is the person in the household, an auntie, it could be an uncle, a grandparent. And we know Ms. Juana Sheesh in the San Ignacio area, 15 children and 90 grandchildren and about 180 great-grandchildren. She is the primary health care provider for that entire progeny. The midwife, of course, is the specialist. Ms. Hortense Robinson was our very dear friend, a herbal midwife who looks after women prenatally, during labor and delivery, postnatal, and then also takes care of the babies and the children. So she's the obstetrician and the pediatrician. The massage therapist, a very, very important function in this society. Usually they take care of backache, neckache, headache, and uterine problems and digestive problems, which is where our Maya abdominal therapy comes in. There are several practitioners right here. Would you mind standing up? Those who have taken the Maya abdominal therapy training, doing wonderful work out there right here in New York City. The bone setter is the person who looks after sprains, breaks, and fractures. They are hands-on, and they also do plasters of different plants to speed the healing. snake doctor, as they describe it, bites, stings, and scorpions, rats, bats, and snakes.
Dogs.
And dogs, right. And the bushmaster, it's a very useful profession. He usually is a guy who is the person who collects for women healers, for the grannies, who can no longer go into the bush to bring down vines and roots and barks. So the bushmaster is a person who knows the remedies, knows how to collect them, what they're for, but usually does not have the patience to deal with patients. That's why they call them patients.
So these are some of the people we worked with. This is Hortense Robinson, as Rose just said, a midwife and much more. Most remarkable person.
Ms. Hortense only passed away in 2010 at the age of 84, going on 85. Hortense Robinson was born in Cozumel Island in Mexico during the days of the Chicle camps, when men went to different parts of the jungle to collect the resin of the zapatilla tree to make chewing gum for the world. Both of her grandmothers were midwives, and she was their apprentice. She did all of the collecting of the medicinal plants for her grandmothers in Cozumel Island. She delivered the first baby on her own at the age of 13. She adopted her first unwanted baby at the age of 15 that she delivered. And she eventually adopted 18 children and had 8 of her own. So she turned out to be a mother, and most of the years of her life, a single mother of 26 children. Miss Beatrice Waite. Mm-hmm. Oh, yes. And this is Andrew Ramcharan of East Indian descent. His father came from New Delhi, from India, and settled in Belize, one of the indentured slaves, if you will, people who got into debt in India or stole an apple somewhere or a loaf of bread and were sent to the British colony to populate. So that's how his family got there. And his father was a snake doctor in India and then taught his son, and that became his son's profession. It's a very important aspect of these traditional healers' lives that they were given a profession through traditional healing and traditional medicine. So Mr. Ramcharan, a very, very famous person in his district because he saved so many lives after hospitals had given up on them.
And Greg reminded me of a story last night. I don't like poisonous snakes much. So on one of these 52 trips, I bought these snake boots that were Kevlar bulletproof up to your knees. And I took them out of the truck, and it took me 20 minutes to lace them up.
In the heat.
It was about 110 degrees. And we were with Mr. Ramcharan, and we go into the forest, and I take 10 steps, and he goes, "Look." And there was a deadly eyelash viper right going at my neck level, right? Bright yellow green eyelash viper. And I thought, boots aren't going to do any good. I walked back to the truck. Took me 10 minutes to unlace these $200 boots. I threw them in the back of the truck. I put my sneakers on, because you can run faster with sneakers. And those boots never saw the light of day again.
Miss Beatrice Waite was a granny healer, a spiritual healer, and a midwife. She was the mother of 9 children. She also has passed away. And she lived in the village of Santa Familia. And she was a very, very strong, very knowledgeable village healer. This is Percival Hezekiah Reynolds, Triple Moon Herbs. He called himself a scientific herbalist because he could read. So he had lots and lots of books on herbal remedies, and he was a very well visited. There was usually a line outside his little wooden house there on the highway on the way to San Ignacio.
And a story with Mr. Percy, his nickname was Sledge, right? I remember that.
He had been a plumber.
Right. Yeah. And he said to me, you know, I read this book about this magical herb that you people have up there in the United States. I'd like you to bring me some. It's called dandelion. I'd like to plant it everywhere in Belize. And I said, I can't do that.
And our dear, dear friend, Don Tomas Green. Thomas Green was a famous Belizean because he was one of the greatest dory makers, which means he would take a live, living tree, knock it down, and after weeks, sometimes months, really months of labor by hand, do a dugout canoe. And he was taken to the World's Fair in New Orleans in the 1980s, and they shipped a tree, a whole trunk of a tree, floating it alongside a ship from Belize City all the way to New Orleans, plopped him down in the Caribbean exhibit, and he dug out that canoe at the World's Fair.
And that's,
Greg and I bought that canoe.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And that's Greg and...
myself, yeah. Don Tomas, and I think that's Rolando or Pablo Cocom, and there are our collection bags collecting along the riverside. And this is Aunt Barbara Fernandez, another very famous market herbalist in Belize City. And this is one of the benefits of the project that we did in Belize, is that we were able to hold 6 different traditional healers conferences in Belize, something that had never ever been done before. And we invited all other traditional healers to come. And our theme was, if you know, come and teach. If you've always wanted to know, come to learn. So Miss Barbara was very kind. She put this human being together with different parts of plants based on their function in the body. So here you have lemongrass for the lungs. There's rue for the brain, and these different parts, different plants for circulation. So Aunt Barbara only passed away last year. Very famous person, always worked in the Belize City market dispensing herbs. And Antonio Cook was Don Eligio's best friend. There he is in Don Eligio's hut. And you see the simplicity of Don Eligio's house, just a stick and thatch hut. And Antonio was a bush master. His wife was the village healer in Don Eligio's village of San Antonio. And he liked to pass time with Don Eligio, just chatting and reminiscing about the old days, 80 or 90 years ago, and help him chop medicine. So Antonio, the bushmaster. And Polo Romero, a bushmaster and snake doctor. Polo is one who had very little patience for taking care of people, but he loved to make his living collecting medicine for others who took care of people. But he is a good snake doctor. He's one of the few who is still living in our very own Cayo district.
And by the way, in the book, there's a whole section called In Their Own Words. And we interviewed maybe 10 people, these people, and they just spoke about whatever they wanted to speak about, their history, what it was like to grow up 60 years ago, what it was like to live in a Chicle camp. So it was very interesting, and instead of trying to synthesize that, we just made that a whole chapter.
Like many of these healers, they represent the cultural heritage of Belize. Polo Romero is a combination of Maya, East Indian, and African, as was Miss Hortense as well. Miss Hortense had a Scottish grandfather, an American Indian grandfather, an East Indian grandmother, and a Maya grandmother, and all these cultures come together, and they learned all of the plants and healing systems of those cultures from their grandparents.
And then one of the ways we would just learn is by passing people on rainforest trails. So this man is Ariel Carreras, as I remember. And he was walking down a trail one day, eating this leaf. I said, oh, can I take your picture? And I said, what's the leaf for? He said, oh, bad stomach. I ate something bad last night. And this was allspice leaf. you know about the fruit, but the leaf happens to be therapeutic too. So just common generalist knowledge, no secrets, no family knowledge that shouldn't be let out of the family. It was all very common knowledge that the people did not want to disappear. And here is the basis for what we do in science at the New York Botanical Garden, and that's collecting plants. We have the largest herbarium in the Western Hemisphere, around 7.5 million specimens of dried plants. How many of you remember first grade when Mrs. What's-Her-Name sent you out during autumn to collect leaves, red leaves and maple leaves, and put them between wax paper? How many of you remember that? Well, that had a very powerful impact on me, because I'm still doing that. And basically, sitting in the mud, putting plants between newspaper, pressing them, and then we mount them on paper.
We said we were impressive.
Yes. And we used lots of different vehicles and things for getting around. The British Army loaned us their helicopters. We had airplanes once in a while, boats. I went through many, many different pairs of shoes that I wore out. But this is Christian Heckert's Unimog that he imported from South Africa, from Saudi Arabia. It was a Mercedes vehicle with tires, you know, half, almost as tall as Rosita, about three quarters as tall, and it could go on these angles. And Greg, Rosita, I, and some assistants would load up stuff and disappear for a week or 2 weeks into a place that was previously inaccessible in this crazy contraption.
And some of the plants we learned because we needed them so desperately. We were in the jungle being absolutely harangued and surrounded by mosquitoes, and a traditional healer would say, you have to drink this plant every day for make your blood bitter. And the bugs then will like it. And so it truly worked. Mm-hmm. Jackass bitters. Jackass,
so
what
we'll
else?
Talk, yeah, we'll show you that in a minute. So the project for the Cancer Institute, as I mentioned, was collecting 1/2 kilo or 1 pound samples of dried leaves, fruits, berries, roots, bark, and people like the cooks would help us dry them. That's Greg on the right, two assistants in the middle, and the cooks on the left. And so you want to dry them out in the sun so as to keep their chemical integrity. But when we didn't have sun, and we were trying to dry hundreds and hundreds of samples, Greg invented something. I'm going to let you talk about this, Greg.
I was looking for something to dry the plants because we were often out there with 70 or 80% humidity and raining all the time, and we were out there for days, and then the plants would get moldy. So I found a hot dog vendor who went bust that wanted to sell this cart. And it's hard to see, but it had sheet metal walls and a roof and a vent on the top. And then I decided to get some cement blocks and a steel plate and a stove, a butane stove. And I hooked it all together and made a box out of plywood and screen on the bottom. And we would put all the plants into the box. The box is right here, this part. And I'd turn on the stove, and we would just have to attend to it so it wouldn't start a fire.
Sometimes it was as many as 60 bags of herbs collected that day that are going to the Cancer Institute. So they have to be seriously dried. If they're not seriously dried, by the time they get to Washington, it's a handful of mold.
This is a butane tank that we would carry that with us, and a copper tubing that's going into the stove, and it worked.
Worked beautifully.
So before Greg painted over the stove, it said, you know, best hot dogs in Belize. People would come up to us, and, hey, you got a hot
dog? I'll have a hot dog.
And so Greg also constructed a dryer in the house. And you see, we were able to process huge numbers of bags.
This was our kitchen.
Was at one time.
And this is another variation with the same box. The inside there is another steel plate with just a regular butane stove. And here's everything stacked up, and we would have to continue moving things around until they got dry.
And then try to keep them dry in the rainforest.
So we'll just go through some plants rather quickly and briefly. These are all from the book. We talk about 900 plants in that book, I think, something like that, with 600 images. So these images, some of these are from the book, some are not. Thank you, Marge, for your work in finding images for us. Ligodium venustum is a fern that just climbs up. And when the children can't sleep at night and they're sort of irritated, you fill the pillowcase with this fern and it calms them down.
They also use it for foot fungus. So it has many plants, multi-purpose. And the
contribuable?
Sorry, no. We're going to go to this one?
Piper.
All right, this is one of the many different piper species in Belize. We have so many piper species, it's like piper heaven, isn't it? Piper is the same family as pepper. Pepper comes from the word piper. And this is a very common plant. It even grows in Florida. I've sometimes seen it in Texas as well. It's called obel. We take the leaf and roll a bottle or a stone over it, and it is wonderful for sprains. If you fall, trip, sprain the wrist, sprain the ankle, it really helps the healing over 3 days as opposed to 10 days. And it's a favorite culinary herb. Local people like to wrap fish in it and then bake it wrapped up in the leaf. Gives it a nice licorice flavor. And you see the flower right there, barely see the flower, but it's a long, white, kind of wormy-looking flower, and indeed it is used for parasites, intestinal parasites also.
And the pipers are used for spiritual bathing, and in fact, Rosita wrote a book called Spiritual Bathing, where a lot of formulas are found. But I remember you mixed, was it 7 or 9 pipers?
Well, Don Alicia always had me collect 9 different plants for the spiritual baths. At least 4 always had to be pipers. Pipers are very powerful for bathing people with that list of spiritual diseases. So the spiritual diseases were always treated with herbal bath or spiritual bathing, and that would be a primary choice. You could do it with just that if you only had it.
So on all these trips, I would be really busy up here in the botanical garden, jump on a plane, come down, and I'd sort of come down with my New York sense of time and urgency. And so Rosita and Greg made me do a piper bath every time I came
arrival.
Down. And we would take the 7 or 9, you know, different leaves, types of piper. And they smelled like sassafras. So there was this hot pot of sassafras smelling leaves and scoop it over me. And slowly but surely, I'd forget what island I came from and I'd remember where I was.
Aha.
We gave him the nickname Dr. Blastoff.
But we did get a lot done.
We got a lot done, yeah, a lot done. I remember one Thanksgiving day, I have to tell this story. It was Thanksgiving in Belize, and we were in our fall collections, and I said to Mike, you know, it's Thanksgiving. I would like to work till maybe 10 o'clock in the morning. We've all been invited for a Thanksgiving lunch and cocktails over at our friend's house, so could we take the rest of the day off? So Mike graciously, 10 o'clock, okay, so we get there at noon, and at 2 o'clock I said, well, I'd like to stay the rest of the day. He said, you know, we got a lot of work to get done today. So this is my favorite plant. Every person who works with medicinal plants eventually gains a favorite. This is absolutely mine. It's Neurulana lobata. It has so many common names. It's called jackass bitters because it's so bitter you have to be one jackass for drink it. It's called golden bitters. It's called mano de largato, which means alligator's paw. It's also called cayabim in Maya. So one of the things we learned in our project is that when we have a medicinal plant with many different common names from different cultures and languages, it's a clue that this is a powerful plant. Why? Because every culture remembered it, has still a name for it. Why do they remember it? Because it works. So this is the plant.
Sorry.
This is the plant we use for all types of parasites, amoebas, skin fungus, candida. It's a powerful antimicrobial, antiviral. There's hardly any critter that tries to parasite on the human body that this plant wouldn't destroy. So we use it a great deal in many different formulas, and also it is in our traveler's tonic for, so that people who come to Belize don't carry home something they didn't buy. It's it's in female tonic because it is a powerful organ cleanser. It is in the immune boost formula because it helps with the immune system. Okay, Mike. This is Contribo duck flower, Aristolochia grandiflor. Now this flower is
18 inches long. And the fish was this big.
That's right. And it looks beautiful, but it stinks to high heaven because it is fertilized by flies. It stinks like rotting meat. But it was one of Don Eligio's favorite medicinal plants to use, part of his formula called saca todo. Saca todo means pull out everything. So again, as an organ cleanser, it is one of those jungle vines that really only a very experienced person like Don Eligio could use. There is some element of toxicity to it. If you don't know what you're doing, you could get into trouble. And the doctrine of signature, or the concept that helps you to realize that, is the stink of death.
And
be careful.
The smell was actually, the plant evolved this smell to attract flies. It evolved the smell of rotting meat so that carrion flies would think that there was something to feed on. They would go down this tube looking for that meat, and they would brush the pollen all over themselves as they went down, and then they would die in there because they couldn't get out. So the tube was always full of sort of dead things.
Dead things, right. This is the vine that you will always find in the rum shop in Belize and the Caribbean for hangover. So after your hangover, you go to the bar in the morning and you get a shot of a big old bottle of rum with that vine soaking in it.
But I never figured out whether it was the rum or the vine that... Metopium brownii is called poison wood or chichem. And think of this as a tree poison ivy. If you got a drop of the black sap on you, you'd get the most horrible, painful irritation like poison ivy. Only unlike poison ivy, this one would spread all through the body, could even go inside.
The myth about it, it's a myth, it may be true, perhaps a legend, that the ancient Maya tied their enemies to the stripped bark of the tree. That would be an awful, awful way to go.
And the legend is that the Maya spirits put the cure next to the scourge. So, very interestingly, we did a plot one day and analyzed the vegetation around these trees. And we found this tree always grows in association with it, the gumbo limbo.
The gumbo limbo, the tourist tree, because it's red and peeling. But the poison wood condition looks just like the bark of that tree, as does a very severe sunburn, very severe kitchen burn, fire burn, measles, chicken pox. It is a fabulous, fabulous remedy as a wash and a tea taken internally. But for the poisonwood condition, which I, on the farm, we had a lot of tourists come by for healing needs. And one of the things was they ran into poisonwood. I have treated people with poisonwood that lasted 18 months. We give them systemic. They have to drink the bark of the tea and then bathe in the bark of the tea as well. And it works every single time as an antidote to the poisonwood.
So we looked at it in a laboratory over in Italy, and it is a very powerful anti-inflammatory, among other things. It's a member of the frankincense family. What do we know about frankincense? It's a resin, right? A resin. And it was the liquid resin from this, the white liquid sap before it congealed, that was so powerful.
Frankincense, myrrh, and copal are all in that family. So when you see that bursera, that is a very, that's a powerful family of tree resins that are very healing.
Now this one is the heliconia. You've all seen heliconia, right? In the beautiful Enidae Health Conservatory, for example. What people would do with this is chop up the leaves. Let's say you had a burn. It's very full of mucilage. Or let's say you had an irritation all over your back and you couldn't sleep. They would put this over the bed, chop it up, and it was a very healing, emollient, mucilaginous for the skin. I think that was the next one.
Okay, pimenta is your common allspice that you can buy in the little McCormick jars in the grocery store. You probably know it for spiced apples, for Thanksgiving, for Christmas time, right? Well, it's called allspice because it has that aroma of cinnamon, somewhat of ginger, and nutmeg and clove. So these are the berries and the leaves of the allspice tree, which happens to grow wild, indigenous in Belize. And of course, it is a worldwide market for the allspice. The fresh green berry is the very best thing for toothache. Nothing works better. Just chomp down on that berry and let it sit on the gum where you have a toothache. It does nothing for the toothache, but it takes away the pain for a good hour, and it helps until you get to the dentist. The leaves are a great tea that Ms. Hortense always used during labor and delivery to help with the process of delivery. It helps the cervix to expand more readily, more easily, and it also keeps the woman calm. It's another remedy that the women in Belize like to give to their children in the winter when the temperature goes down to 60, and the kids say it's too cold to get out of bed. It's a very warming tea.
And interestingly, the old bushmasters in the Chicle camps, when they were out months at a time, they were wearing these rubber boots. They got all sorts of foot fungus. And I learned that you could take the allspice berry, chop it up, mix it with pig fat, and rub it all over your feet, and you wouldn't, it was a very powerful antifungal. I actually tried it, but it's hard to find pig fat, you know, sometimes. But you can always find the allspice and put it in some Crisco oil or something.
And the avocado, we use the leaves of the avocado in a very effective cough syrup. Of course, we all know the delicious nature of the avocado fruit itself. It's very, very healthful. It's good for high cholesterol. It's good for people who are having a hard time gaining weight.
Oops, I'm sorry, this keeps advancing.
Okay, the cecropia, this is the warumo or the trumpet leaf. It's a fascinating tree because it is the first tree that grows after mankind has cleared the forest. It's called a pioneer species. You never ever see it in the middle of the forest. It only grows along the edge where there is enough sunlight. They use it as bush tobacco. They dry up the leaves and sometimes they roll them green, hang them over the fire hearth to dry, and then smoke it like cigars. Greg and I used to make a jungle tobacco, but we had to stop making it because people got just as addicted to smoking that as they did to smoking regular tobacco. And women in Belize like to use it as a postpartum tea to help clean out the uterine membrane. And this is the Morinada Royo?
Misspelled there, Morinda Royac. They
Morinda.
Call it wort vine.
Wort vine.
And in fact, if you have a wart, you split that fruit in half, especially a rotten one, and you wrap it with a piece of cloth around the skin, and the wart disappears within a day. It smells absolutely horrible.
It kind of is like rotten cheese.
Absolutely horrible, but so meaning there must be something in there, and it's very effective. Now, one day Polo got hit in the eye and had a big black eye, and I said, well, what are you going to do? And he said, well, I'm going to take the pad of the cactus and strip off the prickles, and I'm going to put it the gum in my eye. And he did that for 2 or 3 days, and his eye, the redness went away. It seemed to be an anti-inflammatory.
It's a fabulously incredible, useful, edible, and medicinal plant. I had a bruise once from falling on a Maya ruin that was the entire side of my thigh, and it was black. And I put that slice pad on it, and after an hour, when I took it off, it looked like someone had cooked the pad. And a lot of the bruised blood was in the pad itself. So it really helped well. And I think this is a much, much better remedy for burns than aloe. Far superior than aloe, which is great, but this is even better than that.
Now, Vismia macrophylla is a forest tree, a tall forest tree. And you see it has, when you cut the petiole, it has a very yellow-orange sap. And for ringworm, and if any of you ever lived in Florida or whatever, and you get these white spots on your arms, that kind of fungus, a ringworm, you put this on it, and within a few days, it's healed.
Tinea, that's called. Another lovely, lovely plant, Colanchoe pinnata. This has so many common names, it's a paragraph in a book. It's called Life Everlasting, Siempre Viva, and Mother of Thousands. Mother of Thousands, because everywhere the leaf falls, every one of these little dents or crenations in the leaf turns into another plant. So Siempre Viva, because really you can't kill it. It grows, I've seen it in some of the Hispanic stores and restaurants. I've even seen it in the Hispanic hair salons. They grow it. It's a very good remedy for the prevention of asthmatic attacks, for clearing out bronchitis. And they take a fresh leaf, heat it up a little bit over a candle or on the stove, and then roll it up like a tortilla taco, squeeze the juice, add a pinch of salt, and you take a teaspoon a day. And lo and behold, it really does ward off asthma attacks. And in children, it can cure asthma. And it really helps with bronchitis, chronic cough, especially a dry cough. It tastes delightful. It tastes like lemonade. So kids will eat it.
Now, in addition to medicines, we also learned a lot about foods and plants for cosmetics and skin. But this was the chicle. And Polo is showing how in the old days, and still to some degree today, you cut these slashes in the stem and then collect the chicle in a little cup at the bottom.
Sorry?
That's right.
Yes.
Yeah,
now, in addition to plants for food or medicine or for cosmetics, personal care, fungus, we also learned about plants for construction. And this is Polo. And he's showing us how to make a stretcher out of two sticks and some palm leaves. And so when you were in a chicle camp for months and somebody got hurt, they might have to be carried out for 2 or 3 days, right, over trails. And so he put together for one of our classes a stretcher, and there's a gentleman in this room who got carried out on that stretcher in
Stand
the red
up,
hat.
Matt. That's Matt right
here's our victim. he agreed to be the model. And you see the two sticks. It was very comfortable, right? Well padded. Matt, could you imagine a 3 or 4 day ride on that?
Sure, it was great.
Yeah.
Palm leaves and vines tied it together.
And certainly we learned a lot about foods. Portulaca oleracea, the purslane, a wonderful source of omega-3 fatty acids. Mm-hmm. And fruits like Bersonima, the Nancy, a very common tree fruit. And everyone knows this one, right? What is this?
Chocolate. Cacao.
Theobroma.
Mm-hmm.
Grandiflora. Cacao, which is native from this area. Here being toasted over a traditional fire in a comal before it's being sold or ground. Do you want to talk for a second about a wonderful way of making hot chocolate as the Maya used to do?
Right. Well, this would be roasted just as you see here over an open fire. And then the shell has to be removed and then winnowed and then ground. And then what we do with that is just boil it in water, strain it, and add honey or sugar. My husband likes it without honey or sugar. I like it a little sweetened, but nothing else in there. And that actually turns out to be our daily morning drink now for about 20 years. We drink cacao in the morning. It helped us get off coffee. Now if I try a cup of coffee, I feel like I'm like that. But the chocolate is a very mild stimulant. It gets you going, gets you doing your emails, and gets you writing your reports, and you're not shaking while you're doing it. And Belize is one of the international growers for the world of organic chocolate.
Now, in addition to plants for good, there were also plants that were used as poisons. So this is zamia, a cycad, and that root, when you had rats in your house, you would chop up that root and mix it with dried corn and sort of leave it in the corners. The rats would eat the corn, would imbibe the zamia with the cyanide in it, and they would be presently dispatched.
It causes internal bleeding. So the ratones would go back to their nests and die there of their internal bleeding.
Now, also, there are a lot of plants as jewelry. So this is one of the pea family, cojoba. And you see these shiny black seeds, which were then pierced with a hot needle and strung on a necklace. But this particular one was used to ward off malojo, or bad spirits, or evil eye. Especially with kids, the parents would put a necklace of this on their children just to protect them. Now, one of the problems that we faced is widespread deforestation. This for agriculture, for example. At the time that we started working in Belize, there was about 80% of the land in forest reserve and forest cover. And it was quickly going. I think the mantra was 50 acres and a machete. The government would give you 50 acres and a machete if you'd cut it down. And also, if you saw something like a snake, even if it was a good snake, you'd kill it. And so when I first got there, you know, it was pretty grim in a way for the environment. And then, of course, there was logging, pulling out mahogany, beautiful mahogany, so we could have that up here. But what we found was that if you look at this graph, in 1940, we estimated that Don Eligio, it took him 10 minutes to walk to a patch of forest that he could collect his medicines in. In 1984, when Rose and Greg got there, it was about a half hour walk. And then when I got there, it was 75 minutes. And so the medicines were getting further and further and further away as the forest disappeared. So the ability of these people to receive primary health care was being lessened. And we wondered, this is Antonio Cook, and he's got bags of medicine that he was selling, and they were $5 or $10 Belize a bag. And this is Rosita looking at the quality, doing quality control. And we wondered, well, wait a minute, if people are collecting medicines and selling them, and they're also just cutting down forest and burning up those medicines, what's the value of the medicine that could be lost? And maybe that was a way to promote conservation. So here's Greg doing a transect, taking a half a hectare of land, a forest, and counting and weighing all the medicinal plants that are in it, and figuring out what their value would be on the market back then, right? And then we worked with an economist, Rob Mendelson from Yale University, and these were a 30-year-old forest and a 50-year-old forest that we did the transects in, and we did something called net present value. Very simple concept. If you were to buy a parking lot today in Manhattan, you would have to do a net present value calculation of all the money you'd be collecting from the use of that parking lot for the next 30 or 40 or 50 years, and that would have to be factored into the value of that property. Net present value today of future activities. So this was net present value today of collecting medicinal plants from those areas. And from agriculture, we found that you could get about $300 per hectare. Cut the forest down, grow corn, beans, and rice, have 2 or 3 years of crops, and then abandon it. But because of this analysis we did, we found that the net present value of saving a forest but harvesting it sustainably for medicinal plants was 10 times, up to 10 times that value. Really interesting concept. The forest is more valuable standing than cut. And that was when you came up with a concept of stand up for your roots. I remember that. So Belize is a nation of conservationists. There's a baboon, a jungle, a tiger jaguar preserve, but also the
baboon sanctuary
and butterflies. And so the healers and Rosita and Greg came up with the idea of the world's first ethno-biomedical forest reserve for medicinal plants that was called Terra Nova. And so for a decade or so, a lot of activities were undertaken in this based on the value that the forest is worth more than standing than destroyed. And unfortunately, in conservation, it's always one step forward, two steps backwards, and you have to cut your losses but keep going. So today, this no longer exists. It was developed by one of the ministers, I guess, or logged. But all over, once that study was released to the world in a monograph called Conservation Biology, people started making ethno-biomedical forest reserves all over the world, so that people would have a place to gather plants. So I think we did a good
thing. It was a great model for the world, that it was a possibility to take, at that time it was 6,000 acres of unclear jungle, and make it a reserve for medicinal plants and trees.
And for the last 18 years, there's been a bush medicine camp in Belize. We stopped collecting in the late 1990s, I think, but the work continued. And this was your concept?
When Don Alicio passed away, there was a dream, came to Greg in the middle of the night, and Don Alicio said, take the children as though they were your own. Train them and teach them to help each other. So Greg and I contemplated that for 2 years, and I realized myself, having grown up in the inner city of Chicago, the best part of my childhood was the summer camp with the Boys Club. That's where I learned to love trees, where I learned to be at one with nature. So I thought, if that was so meaningful to me, that might be the best thing to do for the children of Belize. So Mike kindly connected us up with the Gilday Family Foundation that have funded our summer bush medicine camp every year for the last 18 years. We have 24 Belizean children from the age of 9 to 12. We invite traditional healers, collectors, snake doctors to come to the camp to be with and interact with the children. They're here, they're planting medicinal trees. And we teach them to use common plants for earache, headache, for baby diaper rash, to do baths on burns, and it's a fabulous, fun summer camp that has been very, very popular in Belize and still going, about to begin next week.
And remember I said when I first got there, Belize was 50 acres and a machete. It was cut and kill and convert. And this is such a beautiful metaphor for me. This plant, it's in the genus Vitex, this plant will not bear shade nor give fruit till these kids are grandparents. and they're planting for their grandchildren. So there's something beautiful about that, you know, spinning it 180 degrees in the right direction. And that, for the New York Botanical Garden, was a great victory for conservation, for East Chelt Tropical Research Foundation that Rose Gregg started. You know, it was one of those wonderful, wonderful moments that you know you've done something that will change people's lives. And we really spent a lot of time with the children in the schools. This is Mr. Ramcharan in the village of Calcutta. He has never spoken to a group of school children before. And here he is talking about his work as a snake doctor.
And the teacher is his grandson. Never thought about inviting his grandfather to come talk to the school children for the first time.
And a lot of community meetings, a lot of competitions. Here was a book contest, Plants in Our Backyard, that people talked about medicinal plants.
Mm-hmm. The children went home and then talked to their grandparents and had to do herbarium specimens and do a proper consultation, the name of the plant and its uses. And through the botanical garden, we were able to give a pretty substantial gift to the school that the children went to that won the contest. And this is a program you put together, Mike.
This was a video that we made for the schools called Learning from Our Elders about one of the healers and their daughter. And we always shared authorship in our scientific papers with the local people who worked with us. So for the first time in his life, Don Eligio Ponte was author on a scientific paper, and he was quite proud of that. Mm-hmm. Constraints to the preservation of traditional knowledge and culture, modernization, diffusion of the family unit, our whole concept of Western society, individualism, leaving a vacuum in the lives of people accustomed to living as a community, television as a substitute for old-time storytelling, a fear that traditional knowledge will be used to the advantage of others, particularly outsiders, a lack of structure or support system for cultural support, which these kinds of projects provide, and the dynamic nature of traditional knowledge, it's always changing. So these are some of the factors that we're constantly addressing in these projects around the world. So we have published probably a total of 10 books as the result of your work, my work, our collaboration, and the latest one, which we'll showcase downstairs in a few minutes, is Messages from the Gods, A Guide to the Useful Plants of Belize, published by our good colleagues here from Oxford University Press, in collaboration with the Botanical Garden, and it's sort of our life's work in that book. So
27 years on the project. Mm-hmm.
So what started with a little visit and a letter and a couple of, yeah, everything looks different, doesn't it? You know, just talking about this idea of preserving habitat and preserving culture and preserving things in a country like Belize, where culture and tradition and environment are hugely respected. Belize is host to over 900,000 ecotourists a year who come to look at her beauty, her friendly people, her
rainforest,
flora and fauna. And so what started as this little idea developed into this large program that is coming to completion. We have one more book to do. I'll tell you about that later.
That's news to me.
But the really nice thing about this is that we involve something like 120 people in Belize in this work. We help strengthen the National Herbarium and the Forestry Department. 20% of all plant collections ever known from the nation of Belize, which are in that national collection in Belmopan, come from this project. We have 20 or 30 hours of interviews with traditional healers and bushmasters and village leaders in the archives at the National Library and elsewhere. It evolved into this huge effort that just consumed all of us. And really, the beauty of it is that we can still look into the eyes of Hortense Robinson in these videos and in her work and in her interviews and understand what she wanted to contribute to the world and to future generations. She was so devoted to children, her children and the children of Belize. And, you know, she said, we have to preserve the forest. She said, we use the roots, the leaves, the stems, the roots. She said, it's without our plants, it's like a mechanic without their tools. We can't do our work.
And then really, one day she said, if I stay home today, I might be able to help 5 or 6 people. If I go with you and Mike, I can help the world.
And so in honor of these several dozen amazing elders that we were so privileged to work with during that 30-year period, you know, we have this book dedicated to them, and hopefully you'll enjoy the product.
We should tell them why it's called Messages from the Gods. Messages from the Gods, because most of the knowledge and wisdom that is recorded in this book and our so many years of efforts with the traditional healers came in dream visions. Don Alicia always said, if I have a patient and I think it's a really bad cough and I'm giving medicine for a cough, and if it's not a cough, it's something more serious, that night I get a dream. And a Maya spirit comes to me and says, old man, you don't understand that sickness. That's not just a cough, it's a lung infection. And this is the plant, this is the remedy that you need to give them. So that's why it's called Messages from the Gods.